Good evening, and welcome to Cornell University's College of Architecture, Art, and Planning. I'm Bob Balder, I'm the Executive Director, and we're very excited to have some old friends and some new friends here to join us for a very special evening. And on behalf of Dean Kent Kleiman from Cornell, we're very excited to be able to host this series and also introduce many of you to our new venue here in Lower Manhattan. You might have been in our old space at some point in the past. We were up at Union Square. And of course, with the changes in New York City's real estate, we finally found a fabulous home here in the former Standard Oil headquarters building. This was where J.D. Rockefeller built his oil empire, the great Standard Oil monopoly. And it's somewhat appropriate that we'd be talking about multiple waterfront issues that have a direct impact on the future of the city as it relates to climate change and resilience in what was once the center of the carbon world was in this building. And you can imagine all the decisions that were made in the era of Rockefeller. But of course, they left in the 50s, and the building's gone through many changes since then. So we find it appropriate that Cornell is now here. This is really our center for architecture in New York City. Some of you may not have ever known that Cornell is a presence, but it is allied with the university's efforts at Cornell Tech that's being built and will open up next year at Roosevelt Island. We will remain in this space. This is really our home for architecture and urban planning, urban design, landscape architecture, and we also have a fine arts program here. So hopefully we'll have you back on successive Wednesdays, and we also have our own Cornell program, which does focus on all the core topics that I just outlined. So without further delay, I want to be able to welcome the Executive Director of the Waterfront Alliance, Roland Lewis, who is probably familiar to all of you by now. Roland has been really leading this extraordinary effort now for almost 10 years now, I believe. It's gone a very quick 10, and obviously extraordinary leadership, and we're very happy to be able to partner with his staff and obviously all of the invited guests. So again, thank you for coming, and let me turn it over to you.
Thank you. Extend my thanks to Bob, who's been a gracious host, and we're honored to be here and amazed. It's my second time up here, and I'm still, my jaw drops when I walk around and look at that view and see the beautiful work that's being done by him and his students. I want to welcome you all here, and I'll start by also thanking our sponsors, Arcadis and AKRF, who generously have underwritten this series for us and allowed us to put it on. I want to thank my staff, led by Jose Sogar, to be hearing from a little later, who's really put this series together and is also working feverishly on our conference, which is a mere few weeks away. If you like the deep dive series, you'll love the conference. It's out on a boat as you famously float around stake up dockside for half the day and then out there on the water. A really wonderful content, so I encourage you to go online at waterfrontalliance.org, check out the thing, and it's also an amazing bargain, even at full price, but for the not-for-profit and government rate, it's a steal. So I'll see you there then, too. Today's topic is something near and very dear to the Waterfront Alliance access. We work for it all the time. I see Captain Maggie Flanagan there behind Jose is leading our effort to try and create more dock space for people to get break that fourth wall, get in the water. But I want you also, as you're listening to the really wonderful work of the HEP program that Rob and Kate will be presenting this evening, and then having the comments by Erika and Willis afterward. Think expansively about access, what it really means. One thing that we've done recently is called our WEDGE guidelines, Waterfront Edge Design Guidelines, which encourages access as well as resiliency and ecological improvement, but access for all kinds of waterfronts. We've certified a couple of projects, for instance, a maritime facility in Staten Island, which allowed for sight lines. You can't get out to it because it's a maritime facility. It's security reasons, you cannot get out to the water from there, but you can see the water now because they did a better job of situating the building. Sims Recycling, an industrial facility in Sunset Park, allows for education at their facility for people to come and learn about recycling and see the water. So even, and most famously, the Greenpoint sewage treatment plant, where they're a you know what factory. There's actually a get down there on Newtown Creek. So you know, you can do access in almost any space, industrial otherwise, if you define it a little broadly and think creatively. So I hope you all will challenge the wonderful speakers we have to think creatively. I'll ask you also, you'll have a sheet of paper, right, that has, is it a website? Or, there's a
go
website.
Vote,
what's that?
Go vote.
Yeah, go vote something or other. It's on that piece of paper, and you can use your computer machines to do that. And you'll be able to, Jose will guide you expertly when we get to that point in the program. But now I'll just I'll hand it over to my good friend Rob Pirani, who's the moderator of the panel, and will set us some opening remarks and get us rolling. All right? Is that right? That's
yep.
Right. All right, thank you very much. And by the way, a Cornell grad.
Yes.
Go Red.
So, well, thanks, Roland and Bob, as well, for hosting us. Yes, Cornell, a very proud Cornell grad, and so happy to be here and see Bob's wonderful new facility here, and know that the Urban Planning Farm is continuing to do great work. My name is Rob Pirani. I'm the program director of the Harbor Estuary Program. I'm really happy to be here this evening. Really great to see what a terrific turnout that has joined MWA or WA in this event. For folks who don't know about the Harbor Estuary Program, we're a part of the National Estuary Program. The Congress and defined 28 national estuaries around the country. And designated at the request of the governors of New York and New Jersey, the New York Harbor was designated as one of those estuaries. And HEP works now out of our new home at the Hudson River Foundation to bring together folks to arrive at some consensus on some shared goals to support the science and data gathering around those goals. And then convening decision makers, whether they're managers or policymakers, to help execute, or the civic sector, to help execute actions to kind of address those priorities. So one of the things we've focused on is, as you'll can tell, is public access. And, you know, I think the reasons are obvious. You know, the Harbor Estuary is the largest public space in the nation's largest metropolitan area, what defines New York and New Jersey in many respects. It, you know, sort of famously, when the New York mayor was putting together the grid plan for Manhattan back in 1811, getting nervous about my planning roots here, they said, well, we don't need so many parks because we've got all this water. And unfortunately, you know, kind of true, but unfortunately that water was not really accessible to the public for many, many years. And, you know, we know that it's so critically important, whether it's swimming, boating, fishing, or just enjoying the views, you know, that access to the water is an amenity that both drives quality of life and results in important investments here in the metropolitan area. It's been correlated with increased physical activity levels and public health, and it's critical for fostering a connection with our natural environment, especially for young people. And I know there's a bunch of Harbor School folks here who are kind of front and center of that work here in the region. So for all those reasons, ensuring and improving public access is an important goal that's shared by all levels of government, and it's something that dates back to common law that started in Rome, believe it or not, the Roman Emperor Justinian in the 6th century. So it's something that's been with us as a public good for a long, long time in the Western tradition. In the last 20 years here in New York and New Jersey, we've started to make some tremendous gains in that. And right outside the doors here of this building, you know, you can see whether it's Battery Park City or a refurbished Battery Park or the East River Esplanade, you can see a lot of new and improved public spaces. But, you know, I think the question that HEP, as sort of a group that helps bring people together and start setting kind of benchmarks for how well we're doing on all kinds of topics, you know, what the question we asked ourselves was, you know, is it enough? And you know, furthermore, what do we really mean by public access? You know, in some cases, you know, as Roland mentioned, it's really that idea of touching the water and getting into the water, whether it's sort of swimming or boating or other kinds of activity. You know, in other places, you might be able to get to the water's edge, but you can't get into the water, and sometimes that's due to safety concerns or management issues. In some cases, it's due to poor water quality and public health and safety. And, you know, I guess really fundamentally, you know, once we know what it is and where we need it, you know, the question is, how do we get there? And we were really fortunate in putting together the study you're going to hear about in a second to be working with the U.S. Forest Service, and you'll hear from Erika Svendsen in a second, about how the civic sector and that kind of network of stewardship organizations can really play a leadership role in making public access happen. And sort of by understanding sort of stewardship turf and where people are operating and what they're doing and how they're networked, we can start to really sort of make better use of that collective will and understanding and capacity to do a better job of increasing the public's ability to get to the waterfront. So we have a terrific panel to help us address these and other questions. And we also have you, you know, obviously a great audience and very handsome audience, I would add. I like to, as a moderator, I always like to, you know, like flatter the audience. It's a really, you know, a critical lesson, you know, you should all take home with you. Here's what we're going to do. Our panel is going to lead us off, and in particular, Kate Boicourt from the Harbor Estuary Program is going to kind of give you, kind of go run through the study and what our findings are. And then Erika Svendsen, our co-author, is going to drill down a little more deeply on the question of civic stewardship. And then finally, Willis Elkins from the Newtown Creek Alliance is going to talk a little bit about kind of what it means from sort of one civic steward, from his perspective working on Newtown Creek, how does this all come together? You know, then it's going to be really your turn. And as Roland mentioned, you know, Jose has set us up with some interactive polling. So we'll be asking you some questions, and then we'll have our panel kind of respond to it, and we'll take some additional questions from the audience. So with that, let me introduce our first speaker, and that's Kate Boicourt. I'm really fortunate to work with Kate at the Harbor Estuary Program. She's our restoration program manager, and she works not just on public access, but also on our habitat issues and climate change issues. Hard to believe, she actually had a life before the Harbor Estuary Program. I try not to think about it. But she was down in Maryland working on the climate change adaptation plan for the state of Maryland, and has done a lot of other work kind of working with scientists and the public and government to advance public policy in the marine world.
So thank you, Rob and Roland. I think you all did a very good job of setting the stage before I break everything over here for why we care about public access. So thanks for doing that. So I just want to start out first by kind of acknowledging a number of people who are in this room and outside of it. We worked very heavily with the Forest Service on this project, and also we worked with sort of a large group of multiple agencies, nonprofits, to kind of advise this project. And this project was a big sort of assessment, both at a desktop, kind of working with map scale, but also a large assessment of a lot of stewards around the harbor. And tonight I actually met somebody that was a respondent to our survey. So thank you all for helping to get this done. So first of all, I wanted to talk a little bit about what our goals were. And Rob sort of highlighted a few of these. I think first and foremost, we really had no baseline. We have these regional goals for by 2050, the Comprehensive Restoration Plan for our region is, we want all waters accessible within a short public transit trip or a short walk. And so we needed to have sort of a place from which to start to measure those goals. We also wanted to identify where we don't have access. So really, where are those areas where we need access, new physical access, but also programming and ways to get people to the water where there may be access, but maybe people don't know about it, or maybe there's limited resources. And we also wanted to understand what is our existing capacity and potential capacity for stewardship, and that's where our friends at the Forest Service really came in and kind of helped us work on that. And I'll talk about this a little bit at the end, but we really will be using this in a number of ways. So we actually give out small grants to public access stewards, those that are conducting educational programming on the waterfront, and this will actually inform a grant cycle which is out right now, in fact, so you should all apply if you have not seen it. And it also is a community tool. So if you're going to your local participatory budgeting process, you can say, you know, I have this map that shows me where there is and isn't access in my region. So I think there are many different ways that we hope it'll be used. So firstly, our study area. To keep in mind with the sort of short walk or public transit trip, we had about a half mile buffer that we buffered our whole region, and you can kind of see it there. And we looked within that, and we basically tried to come up with a way of looking at public access and defining it that made sense to us and our partners that work in public parks, et cetera. And we kind of came up with these three main categories that are considered public access. And those are parks, other, in which we have sort of our esplanades, our boat ramps, our sort of public-private partnerships where there's a deed restriction. And then we also had limited access, and these are areas where they're publicly owned. They might be owned by New York City Parks, such as a heron nesting island, but you can't really get there for various reasons. And then our gaps in access, and these are a few examples of areas where there might be limited access. And actually the woman, she's not strangling the bird, she's measuring it. Should have been in the previous slide. But basically, you know, we're cut off from the waterfront for a number of reasons, and then some of them are actually not physical. I've given some physical examples here. And some of them are temporary. Maybe there's future parks, or maybe there's sort of a limited access, like at the Navy Yard, where it's controlled. So here's our map, and we also have it online. So you can zoom in, and these tiny little lines will actually be a little bit more easy to see. But basically, we have about 1,600 of linear miles around the waterfront. And about 60% of that is inaccessible due to gaps or security zones. And that's around our airports, our ports, basically sensitive homeland security zones where, you know, you're not allowed to go. But we also found that there's over 41,000 acres of public access, which is pretty exciting. And we also did some research a couple years ago where we found that about 500 of those acres were either opened or restored in the past 5 years. So a lot has been happening, as Rob alluded to. We also wanted to try to get at this question of direct access. So that's, can you get down to the water? Can you get from the water? Can you touch the water? It's a really hard question to get at. And I have to say there's still more work to be done. But we did a little bit of that where we mapped all of the human power boat launches and all of the swimming beaches as sort of a proxy for some of that access. And we also, in our assessment of stewards, we asked, can you safely touch the water? And about 183 sites throughout the harbor of over 600 said yes. That's not a comprehensive view, but that was pretty astounding. So we also really wanted to get at this question of who is public access serving and how is it distributed? Is it equitably distributed? Public access is also potentially an environmental justice issue. And we wanted to look both sort of physically where there is access, but also from a socioeconomic perspective. And that can tell us something about, do we need to target our efforts for establishing more access in this area? Or maybe do we need to support more organizations to provide more programming to bring people to the waterfront? And I should say that these are course indicators, but it's sort of our starting point. So what we looked at, we had these kind of five indicators which we stacked on top of each other. We used a lot of U.S. Census data to do this study, and then we also basically used our buffer and figured out of that sort of 5.3 million population that lives within that buffer area, who has access within a half mile of the waterfront or a waterfront park. And I'm going to grab my notes here. But basically, we found that overall, about 17% of the people within that buffer do not have access. And again, that's based on that last metric. We also looked at linear access. So we can tell you exactly how much of the linear coastline is accessible. And those are sort of two ways of getting at that question. And on average, harbor-wide, we found that about the average income is about 67,000. We've got 3.5% growth, 58% communities of color, and 17% youth populations. And remember that real fast, because we're going to get to the next thing, where we tried to look at, we basically took those data and then looked at where those sort of areas of highest need are concentrated. And that was the lens that we looked at these areas of higher need. And we talk about that a little bit more in the report. I think that there aren't any more copies out there, but it's online. And I might have a couple that I can share to people. But basically, we looked at each of these areas and tried to understand a little bit what was going on. On the whole, in all of these higher need areas, and those are the red, we basically found that there's about 500,000 people, and they're about 47% without access. So that's higher than the Harbor average, which is really interesting. And on average, they earn about $20,000 less than the Harbor-wide average. They actually have lower percent growth, maybe not surprising. They also have higher youth populations. So again, that we're sort of aggregating these data, and we can tell something about these areas, but there's probably a lot more detail that we could get into. So what we found, just a real quick kind of highlight of a few areas, because we don't have a lot of time. So a lot of these probably won't surprise you. The North Shore of Staten Island, for example, we know has very limited access for a number of reasons. And they also have really high youth populations, and those really kind of jump out there. In Jamaica Bay, which is known for its national parks, its park access, there are certain areas where it's really hard to get there, or there's a large swath of JFK Airport, which prevents access for some of these populations. And there's other areas in the Harlem River where there's really not a lot of sort of linear access as well. So there's a lot of different things that we can look at within each of these, and I'm happy to talk to you more about them. Also very important, especially with our partners at the Forest Service, we looked at civic stewardship. And again, this was based on this big assessment of over 100, we had about 147 civic groups kind of respond to this assessment, which was really exciting. And so this was sent out by email, thanks to Waterfront Alliance. We also publicized it. We emailed and gave out hard copies. We called people. Thank you. And we also promoted it by e-newsletters. And as a result, we had over 160 groups respond. 146 of those were civic organizations, and that means, you know, not New York City parks, not our government entities, and we mapped them. So we find a higher concentration in Manhattan. Our friends at the Forest Service tell us that it has something to do with density, but there may be other factors at play, so that's something that we might be interested in getting into more. We also found a higher response rate on average in New York versus New Jersey. I thought this was interesting. I mean, I think we don't often think necessarily of motivations for stewardship in our organization, but it has a lot to do with how people engage. And I think basically what Rob and Roland were talking about earlier is why we care. Well, if you touch the water and you know about the water, you probably care more about the water. So I think we wanted to know a little bit about what these groups worked on, and we basically were focused on waterfront organizations. And we found that over 40% spend 80 to 100% of their time on stewardship, that's, I guess, self-defined, and most focus on the environment and education or recreation as primary focus. We also found some interesting things about budget. I think the annual budget for a lot of these organizations, I think, is something like 35% is less than $50,000, which should tell us something about the capacity of these organizations. And yet a lot of them, which is not on here, have a lot of volunteer hours. So they have a lot of sort of people hours and capacity, but they may not have funding to do other projects. So that's important for us as funders to know, and our friends who are also providing funding to these groups. And I found this also very interesting in a realm where we're sort of going a little bit more towards different kinds of funding strategies. There's still a lot of individual giving here, which was also very interesting. So that's probably membership based. And where do these organizations work? 57% conduct stewardship in parks. So hey, maybe our parks are doing pretty well. If you get to the map online, you can kind of zoom in and see where there is and isn't some activity going on that might be a little bit hard to see here. But we have about half conducting work actually on the waterfront or along the shoreline. So that's a huge opportunity for us to kind of stimulate that engagement with the public. So what are we going to do with this? It'll inform our own planning, as I mentioned, and our own funding. It also gives us sort of a way, a baseline to track change, and ideally we'd like to increase access. And I think Rob got to this a little bit, but we really need to sort of take this and think about, well, what does access mean? How do we kind of take that beautiful Justinian public trust doctrine that we now have as part of our body of law, and think about, well, what does public access mean, and what should our goals be for direct access and all of those different aspects of access. And then also, we really need to do a good job about sort of sharing this with our community. I think that there's a lot within this report that can really help people sort of say, here's some data, and this is what's going on in my stretch of the river. So I think that's it for me, and I will turn it over to Rob to introduce the next speaker.
Well, thanks, Kate. So our next speaker is Erika Svendsen. Erika is a research social scientist at the Forest Service Northern Research Station. That's part of that job is being the team leader for the New York City Urban Field Station, which is a partnership between the Forest Service, New York City Parks, and other cooperators. She's a co-author of a book on civic engagement and stewardship, and actually won an award, the Forest Service Chief's Award. Did that come with like one of those hats?
I didn't even get a stuffed Smokey Bear, but I got a nice wooden bowl, which was it's just nice to be honored.
Well, but she was recognized, despite, you know, maybe pathetically honored, I guess, but for engaging urban America in an early career scientist award for the co-development of the stew map, which is part of what this research was part of. So, Erika.
Oh, great. Thank you. Rob and I used to work together.
You
didn't tell them that.
It's the next slide?
Yeah.
I just screwed up. We're done. Okay. So I think, yeah.
Yep.
So just click back.
There we go. Well, thank you very much for that nice introduction, and it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks to our hosts, Cornell and the Waterfront Alliance, of course. And Rob and Kate for bringing myself into this project, as well as Lindsay Campbell and Michelle Johnson with the U.S. Forest Service, into their really engaging discussions about the waterfront access and stewardship capacities early on. I think from the get-go, we were kindred spirits because the group at HEP was really interested in this issue of access, but really toggling that with the importance of stewardship, in particular civic stewardship, but also recognizing the private sector as well as government, and knowing that any type of access that we're going to get into or strengthen or talk about is really going to require stewardship in place and that group on the ground. So that's a lot of what we study at our field station in New York City, so we're happy to partner. And so the next couple of slides in my presentation is brief, but I just wanted to give you a sense of how we embed these waterfront stewardship groups into a larger system of stewardship. The Forest Service, just to give you, you know, why is the Forest Service involved in this project? I mean, we consider New York City a social ecological system, so we're interested in the trees and the water and the sun and the people, the whole thing. And we don't regulate land or own any land in the city, so we're really here to work with our partners to learn where there's gaps in the research and in the science and program and where we can add value. We do have a base here in Lower Manhattan in the Federal Building, and we're also out at Fort Totten where we have a lab and a residential facility, so come visit us. And we try and create a place of innovation really between research and practice. So like I said, a lot of our work is on civic environmental stewardship in the urban context, and we define environmental stewardship quite broadly. So all those individuals and groups that conserve, manage, monitor, advocate, and educate the public about the local environment. So that probably includes all of you. So we cast the net pretty broadly, and we're interested historically on those groups that emerged basically from the street corners, from the local edges and ends, if you will, rather than the large national groups, although we understand how those groups have historically played a role in the American environmental movement as well as in cities. But in the cities, I think we all know it's a little bit more grassroots. So when we embarked on StewMap, and HEP was one of the first data providers way back in 2007 for the StewMap study, and this was done in collaboration with Lindsay Campbell and Dana Fisher, we really wanted to visualize the actions of civic groups. We know where government works. We know often where the private sector is, but we don't know where groups of friends and neighbors and organizations have been, you know, working in this way for a very long time. So we really just wanted to give rise to that and to visualize that, because we know that stewardship doesn't really just exist, it persists, right, over time and space. So we wanted to highlight gaps and overlaps and also show a bit more equity in that system. Often the groups that get highlighted are the ones that get captured on the front of the New York Times, when you did read the front of the New York Times as opposed to now. I'm dating myself, but you know, we wanted to show all the efforts of those groups and to show some parity in the system. So we did the StewMap survey in 2007, and it's since expanded to several cities in the US. Each time we do another city, we learn a little bit more. It started with a group of civic organizations for which the environment was embedded in what they ordinarily do, right? So it wasn't just environmental groups. And it's interesting to think about how the waterfront is embedded in the work and interests of many other unexpected groups and individuals that are out there. So HEP was a part of this first ever StewMap study, and with the past study now that we've just done, we now have a longitudinal data set. It's the first time we have longitudinal data for mapping stewardship, so we're really excited to do more. So these next couple of slides just give you a sense of why we do what we do. We're very interested in what we call stewardship turf, and we just began to map that turf with Kate and Rob. Just with this report, but we feel like we could go a bit deeper. Stewardship turf is kind of the area that groups are maintaining, and that has a boundary, right? But that boundary often shifts over time. It rises and falls in political power as groups gain rights and responsibilities to a space. So we really feel that this is an important area, this stewardship turf, to study and to learn about, because they're places of expertise, of local expertise, of innovation, of knowledge, and in many ways, a lot of the ways that people organize themselves to care for the environment on the waterfront or in other places throughout a region, they come up with really novel ways to partner. And so we see those as new forms of governance, if you will, worthy of our attention and worthy of our study. I'm just going to go back. Well, I'll just say it. One other thing, you know, when we map stewardship intensity, where we find the most number of groups, and you saw that in Kate's maps, that's really interesting too. And there seems to be a pattern, at least with the stewardship mapping citywide, that in the places where we have the least green, we see the most stewardship activity. And that reminds us is how essential the water, green space, open space is essential to us as human beings. This is a stewardship network map. This is for the city of New York, circa 2007. It maps the relationships between civic groups, government, and the private sector. And so we're very excited to now work more closely with the HEP data that we have. And when we do this analysis again, we're going to be able to see how this network configuration has changed almost 10 years later. And what we want to look at in that change is many things, but I'll just highlight two right here. One is the isolates. That's that ring of groups that are on the outside of that little circle there. Those are what you would say the most vulnerable groups in some ways, perhaps. They're the groups that are one or two links away from being totally outside the network and not engaged with anybody else. But sometimes those are the groups that are the most innovative. Those are the groups that are doing some really creative stuff, so we want to know about them. We want to target them and understand how that they are participating and strengthen their role in the network. Over here, we have what we call the nodes or the brokers. These are the groups where information travels through, resources, energy, the go-to groups. And those groups are obviously very important for reasons that you know, if you're working at the level of New York City and trying to launch a program, these nodes are really great gateways to other groups. So it poses as a very efficient way to work and to organize. So as we advance our understanding of this network with the HEP data, the new data set that we have, we hope to, that'll be the next deep dive for us. Also, another place where we're already going deeper is through the work of Jan Enquist, who's here from the Stockholm Resilience Center. He's working with us this spring. And he's begun to study the waterfront groups. He studied stewardship groups in other parts of the world, but he's studying our waterfront groups to better understand their connection to place and nature and the social meaning that underpins it. So he's doing the kind of work we can't do with a survey or an online survey. He's kind of going out in the field and doing these in-depth interviews. So if he calls upon you, you know, answer his call. All right, and in conclusion, it's a real honor and to be just a small part of this effort. We learned a whole lot. I want to recognize our multi-city StewMap team, as well as a special thanks again to our hosts and to Rob and Kate. Looking forward to expanding this more and more. Thanks.
So, you know, I think the work of us as planners and scientists, you know, in sort of understanding what's happening from that kind of, you know, bird's eye view and that sort of policy perspective, I think is critical so that we can kind of shape both government policy and kind of think about where we're best to invest resources, where, you know, what, how best to sort of aid groups. But, you know, I think we all know within the room that it doesn't mean anything until it hits the ground and things happen. And so we're really thrilled that Willis Elkins is here to talk to us a little bit about sort of on-the-ground activity that he's engaged with as a sort of an example of the sort of stewardship stuff and the public access efforts we want to promote. Willis is the program manager for the Newtown Creek Alliance, which oversees a number of different projects on a currently largely inaccessible Superfund waterway in the heart of New York City. He's busy on any number of other ventures as well. He's a founding member of the North Brooklyn Boat Club. He's the co-chair of the Newtown Creek Superfund CAG. He's a member of Brooklyn Community Board 1, and he's on the steering committee of New York City Water Trail Association, which means that he's doing a lot for the city. It means that we're really excited that he's here, not at the other four meetings he could have been at tonight. So thank you, Willis.
Hi. Thanks again to the hosts and the sponsors and Waterfront Alliance. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the specific issues and challenges that we've been facing in Newtown Creek. So maybe I start with a show of hands. Who has been to Newtown Creek? Oh wow, a lot of people. That doesn't include driving over the BQE, right? Okay, so that's great because Newtown Creek, despite being very close to Midtown Manhattan and the border between Queens and Brooklyn, and really large neighborhoods like Williamsburg and Greenpoint and Long Island City, so these neighborhoods that are really growing, as well as Bushwick and Ridgewood, is very inaccessible. And some stats about the creek: it's about 3.5 miles long. It has a number of tributaries, and it has about 11 miles of shoreline total, which I always think is pretty interesting because it's a very under-recognized waterway. It's pretty much completely industrially zoned. The mouth is residential, so some of these projects like Greenpoint Landing and Hunters Point South are just coming online, and so the mouth of it is residential, but the core of it is industrial. For Newtown Creek Alliance, we've been around for about 13 years, and our mission is to reveal, restore, revitalize Newtown Creek, and there's always been a heavy emphasis on preserving that industrial core, because a lot of people that were, you know, involved in the beginning and still involved realized that we need to have these industrial sectors to have jobs, to have good jobs, and we want to maintain that aspect of Newtown Creek. That being said, we take a sort of a comprehensive approach at preserving the industry, but also revitalizing the ecology of the water. That's a very big one, and also engaging the community and making it more accessible. So access. I mentioned there's 11 miles of shoreline. There is only really two, we say, intentional access points on the creek. They're both towards the mouth, and they're both in on the Brooklyn side, and they're both in Greenpoint. And so all of that Queens shoreline basically has no point where people are encouraged to get to the water. And so this is something we've been working on because we feel that in order for this waterway to get cleaned up, it is a federal Superfund site. We have other huge issues with CSO, like most of New York and New Jersey. Our CSO probably have about 3 billion gallons of CSO overflow every year, and we have it in places where the water is very stagnant, so the impacts are much greater than, not to belittle CSOs, but much greater than if you had a CSO at the Battery or the East River or the Hudson. So we have these very stagnant waters where the only source of you know, active movement is untreated sewage and stormwater. So, but we feel when there needs to be more people need to know about the creek, need to see it, and to fight the long, hard fight with all the agencies to get it to a cleaner state where people can safely have contact with it. So, access, this is a street end in Greenpoint, and this is Apollo Street, and this is actually, again, it's very fitting that we're in this building. Many of you may be familiar with the Greenpoint oil spill, the largest underground oil spill in U.S. history. Thanks to the people that built and inhabited this building. And this at Apollo Street is really kind of the epicenter of where that was. So if you were here, there's actually still, it used to be BP actually a few months ago, a different Kinder Morgan oil company took it over, but there's storage facilities to the west, and this whole area up to about 50 years ago was all standard oil refineries and storage and whatnot. So this is kind of a typical unofficial access point on the creek. We have one of the things that, since we're interested in preserving a lot of the industrial core, when we talk about access and restoration, you know, we're looking at these small little interventions that don't take a lot of resources. We don't want to go in and suggest buying up a huge industrial site to make a park, but looking at street ends is a really obvious way. And so some of these street ends are former bridge crossings, and some of them are just places where it ends. And naturally, these are places where some people already converge, despite, you can see the conditions are not very inviting. People use it to dump trash historically, much worse stuff, since the area is industrial and you can get away with whatever you want. So this is a challenge. We've been trying to engage more with New York City DOT because they manage a lot of these street end sites. And it's been very difficult because this is a low priority. Not a lot of interest in getting to a polluted waterway. There's also particularly not a lot of interest on the agency's part of bringing people to a polluted waterway. And anything that deals with soil is really tricky because, as I said, you have the oil spill and lots of other you know, chemical contaminants and plumes nearby. So this is a site we still really want to make something happen that has some potential, but a lot of challenges. Here's another site that's a bit more of a, this will get uplifting, more positive as we go on. This is a site we call Plank Road. It's on the Queens side in Maspeth. And originally this was a bridge crossing, a bridge called the Maspeth Avenue Plank Road, a bridge that connected Maspeth over what was Furman Island that was later filled in and connected to Queens, and then over into East Williamsburg, which is why there's actually Maspeth Avenue that runs along Cooper Park in Williamsburg, despite not being connected to Maspeth. And this is a cool site because it actually, you can kind of see there, it actually gets down low to the water. So it's another one of the issues with the creek is the environment. You know, it was turned in from this vast marshland into a canal for all the maritime traffic that was so prevalent in the late 1800s and early 1900s. But this actually gets really close to the water, a point where if at high tide you can go down and you know, touch the water pretty easily. And so members of Newtown Creek Alliance had seen this site. It had a lot of problems, same thing with this dumping. A lot of people brought trash to dump there. It also has a real big problem with flooding and runoff. And it's at the end of this street, so it naturally gets a lot of overflow. There's two catch basins on either side, but they've been clogged for some time. And again, it's been very difficult to get DEP to come out and unclog these because it's not you know, the Upper West Side or Park Slope. So we have a constant stream. There was also a leaky, we found out it was a water main coming up from the street a block away that was constant, so there was a constant stream of water coming through here. So a few years ago this was completely muddy, overgrown, there was lots of trash. We got a small grant with HEP to do some cleanup stuff. So here's one of our cleanup days, removing some of the weeds. We removed a lot of trash. Fortunately, sanitation has the facility right next door, So they're very happy to take our trash bags when we get stuff from there. And this is what it looked like. This was in October. And so we've done a lot of stuff, aside from trying to stop the stream coming through, but we've removed a lot of the trash. We brought in some gravel. We actually worked with a concrete company next door, which is one of the models for us, is looking for local good partners who want to help out. And so we did some, you know, landscaping. We planted some more stuff. And we also put in signage. That's a big thing as well. The creek has this kind of amazing history of the industrial activity. So we put an old map from the 1800s there, gave some general information about the creek as well. That's also something we feel is lacking, is the history, but also the state that the creek's in and what you're actually looking at. You know, a lot of times people will come down to a place like Newtown Creek and not, you know, just say, oh, it's water, I don't know what this is. But so the information is really important for us. So this is kind of what it looks like. We're still having challenges with this runoff, but we're hoping to do more of this, you know, small grassroots stuff. This was basically, you know, me and a couple other people from NCA. It's very tricky in terms of this idea of the stewardship. The creek is a really challenging place for that, because although we get people that live nearby who are interested and say, you know, can we come pick up trash or do something like that, or how can we help clean up the creek, the scale of the pollution in the creek, you know, it's federal Superfund level. So it's not like we can just say, you know, here, grab a shovel, bring your kids, we're going to scoop up some toxic sediment. It's really difficult. Even stuff like this we don't really like to encourage a lot of the public to come help us with the planting, because we know that the soil has really elevated levels of things like lead and stuff like that. So it's very tricky to do this stewardship type work on the creek. Nevertheless, that's Plank Road. You guys should check it out if you're around the industrial section of NASPA. On Sundays, it's very nice because all the industrial activity is completely dead. It's actually probably one of the most quiet areas in the city on a Sunday. This is, actually, Roland mentioned this earlier, this is one of the formal access points, the Newtown Creek Nature Walk. It was built as they did the upgrade for the wastewater treatment plant in Newtown Creek, which is the largest one in the city. We handle a lot of sewage, including from this building itself. And as part of that upgrade, they had to do this 1% program to give 1% of the budget to an art project. And they worked with George Trakas, who was a really awesome artist, who came up with this idea of creating this public esplanade called the Nature Walk, which always kind of bewilders people when they come there, because it's in the middle of this industrial corridor with the scrap metal and cranes going everywhere. But it's kind of beautiful. And I think also the steps that Roland described too, it's kind of awesome, because the creek has been so much fenced off, both with the bulkheads, but also all the properties are privately owned, barbed wire fences. And so to create these steps where you're kind of enticing people to get in the water, but it's almost like a, you know, it's a dare or something like that. And they're in the end, they're actually not, because of the tide coming in or out there, they're kind of slippery. So there's not really that many people that are like down at the water's edge. But you can see it's great. There's some marshes that planted there, and these little triangle cutouts have actually become really amazing habitat for rib mussels. And of course, you can see the egrets and some geese here. So this is a really, you know, an awesome example, and they're going to expand this. This is one of their cool things too. So the Nature Walk is in this very isolated corner of Greenpoint, where they're going to have it go around a whole tributary and have two entry points in a couple of years, which is really exciting. But this is a great example of, you know, innovative access initiatives that the, you know, fortunately the city took on and funded. This is another project that we did last summer, Newtown Creek Alliance, and we call it the Living Dock. And the idea was that we've seen a lot of wildlife returning to Newtown Creek, which has really been amazing, because anybody who was around that area, familiar with Newtown Creek 50 years ago, which is not me, but you know, everyone knew what it was, how bad it was. And so the sight of something like School of Menhaden fish coming back, or those egrets that we saw, is really surprising to a lot of people. So we've been tracking a lot of this wildlife stuff coming back, eels, horseshoe crabs, you know, herons and all that. And what we want to do is find a way to be able to see some of that wildlife coming back, but also provide habitat. Because as I mentioned, we've lost so much of that intertidal area for all these vital organisms to grow. So we want to provide some clean habitat. So we built it so the middle of it is empty. It's kind of like a smaller, more DIY version of what they have on Governor's Island with the oyster cages underneath their dock. But we built it out so that, you know, we have little habitat units, so we have, we actually just use milk crates, and some of them have old oyster shells to act like a reef. We're checking to see if there's colonization with oysters and mussels, and we've seen some mussels so far. And then we planted some of the Spartina grasses, and it's doing really well, but it's also really good because you can pop out these little habitat units, and you can let, like in one of those little white bins, you can let everything fall out, and you'll just see in the summer, I mean, you'll just see dozens and dozens of shrimp and little killifish, which is really, I think, a powerful, at least people seem to think it's powerful, experience for people to see that there is, this isn't a dead waterway like we've been used to, or even that we've been told by the agencies that there is stuff here. So it's cool too, and so one of the ideas was, you know, we needed a dock because there's so little really good intertidal space along the creek. So this sits along a sort of degraded bulkhead and, you know, sort of acts as environmental restoration, providing small amount of habitat, providing educational opportunities, and also you can paddle a canoe there as well. If sometimes it's usually blocked by a barge, you see this little inlet. But it's a nice spot. It's not on the main channel, so there's no commercial traffic that comes back here. It's actually really protected from wind and wave, so it's a really good spot. And actually, to get there by land is a little tricky too, so it has some sort of vandalism safety proof there as well. So that's really all I have to say. Those are just some examples of the projects we've been working on in this very challenging place, Newtown Creek.
Great. Well, thanks to all our speakers. So now we're going to get into the next, if I can do this, into the next part of the show. And this is really to engage you folks in, how do we make this bigger? So this is the Mentimeter, which is a word I'm going to say from now on. But what it is voting tool. And so hopefully everyone has, you know, read your instructions on the piece of paper that you were given when you were coming in. And what you want to do is now start to vote. And while you're doing that, I want to invite the panelists to come up to the front and take your seats here, and so you can respond to some of those questions. So are folks able to vote?
Yes.
Yeah, we have free Wi-Fi here. It's called Red Rover. So you can just tap right in.
So the first question is, what waterfront or water body do you feel most connected to? Ah, and we have an answer. Okay. Pretty good distribution. Couple more votes, and then we'll go on to that next question. Slowing down maybe a little. But a great range of folks from all over. All right, so, you know, I think we talked about this a little bit. It's kind of, you know, what does public access mean to you? Because, you know, and one of the key issues is it all about getting into the water? Is it, you know, obviously there's a lot of benefits just getting to the shoreline. And we sort of assumed in putting together the list of possibilities there that, you know, it was really about that, that everyone liked to do that, and it was kind of, what else do you want to do? Oh, I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead in terms of the questions. I love freedom.
Sorry.
And I see we have a Bernie Sanders supporter in the house. Swimming with dogs. That's good. I like that too. Yeah, I think this is like proving Erika's theory, right? You know, the big notes, you know, kind of interesting. It's the little ones that are the fun one. All right, let's get a couple more votes and then we'll move on to the next question. Okay. So which of the following have you done in the harbor and waterways? And again, I think this is, I was just leaping ahead here. We sort of assume that everyone likes to get to the water's edge, likes to picnic, likes to, you know, sort of bicycle or run along the water, or just, you know, hang out and enjoy the view. So it's kind of, what else? Big swimming contingent, that's good to see. You know, one of the interesting things I think, you know, that we're all talking about coming out of studies is, you know, one of the findings from the 2007 report was that a lot of the sort of kind of node groups, the groups that were most heavily networked, did a lot of work post-Sandy in terms of kind of helping their communities recover, and if I got that right. And so I think that's, you know, part of the idea with the storm relief is a lot of the waterfront stewardship groups are really, you know, are sort of on the front line. They know the water body, they know the waterfront, they're familiar and comfortable with the water. And when you think about, you know, events where the water comes where it's not normally, they're a lot of the groups that are, you know, might be on, you know, helpful in terms of helping their neighbors kind of cope with the situation. Okay, next question. What are our biggest challenges to public access? So, you know, again, this is, you know, this is an open-ended response. So, that was an interesting comment. I guess the governor of New Jersey is the only politician who's gotten his name up here.
On the next slide.
Scroll down.
Oh, can I?
Yeah, the down arrow. Click on that.
Oh, just click on it. Thank you. So it's interesting because a lot of it is kind of this physical. I mean, I see a lot of questions about physical access, or a lot of statements about physical access, and sort of less about programming and management than I would have thought. All right, and here's our last kind of survey question. And then we're going to go into some questions for the audience. There's some questions. What do civic organizations need to maintain and expand efforts of public access sites? So as kind of this network of civic stewards, what are the most important things that they can do? Getting people out there and getting people right in front of the water, as kind of Willis showed us. I see a couple of votes for that. I like that one, coalition and speaking with a collective voice. And that's certainly a big part of what we try to do at the Harbor Estuary Program. And the Waterfront Alliance, I should add. Right. Well, I think these are some really great observations. The next set is really, and this, and now we'll open it up for some panel conversation. I don't know if the folks on the panel had any reaction to what you're seeing here.
Well, no, I'm just, and this struck me when we started working on the report together, and echoed in Willis's remarks as well, but seeing here in the variety of responses, it's really amazing to see the diversity of the waterfront access spots, and what they entail. And what does that mean? I think about what is needed. You know, each one of these answers can take you in a different direction of how to execute it and how to get the problem solved. So, and I don't mean to minimize or diminish the importance of, like, say, for example, community gardens, which I'm a huge fan and we've done lots of work with community gardens. But there's just so much variety along the waterfront area in New Jersey, New York, and so much differences in responses of what's really needed. Just to comment on that, so what that means, I guess, for programming, if you were a funder, you know, if you're going to give a stewardship grant, like, for example, you know, Willis might not need, as you say, a flat of flowers and, you know, some nice light gloves, but needs specialized equipment, citizen science work, like, you know, his form of stewardship may be very different than a group just around the corner. So I'm just reflecting on that.
That's a good point. Well, you know, let me ask a question before we turn it over to the audience. I mean, given that diversity, you know, can we come up with sort of a unified sort of standard or vision of what public access is? I'd open this up to Willis or Kate as well. You know, is there sort of a goal that we should be thinking about? I think, as Kate mentioned, you know, sort of going into this exercise and sort of dating back to our last action agenda, the goal was, you know, everyone within, you know, a short walk or commute, which we define as being sort of a half mile or a 10-minute walk. Is that a useful kind of construct, or do we need something that's a little more sophisticated or maybe more inspirational even as a standard?
Yeah, I think it kind of depends on the situation. I mean, it's hard for me to imagine, you know, if there was what we might consider access for Newtown Creek, if that was the standard in Jamaica Bay, I would be like, this sucks. You know, like all we have is this like little tiny concrete road to look at the water. And that's partially because of the local conditions with the environmental issues, but it's also land use and the way that, you know, things are designed. So, I mean, I think it would be great, but I think it kind of depends on a couple factors, like how dense the area is around it, the elevations from shoreline. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's such a challenging question, and one that I think we're actually about to launch a bunch of public listening sessions throughout the Harbor Estuary, and we'll definitely be talking about access. It's sort of region-specific, it can be place-specific. I think what the information that we have does tell us is sort of, okay, so given the Passaic River, we have next to no access and long stretches, what kind of baseline can we reasonably achieve? And I think we've done a fair amount of work, but I think we need to sit down with those communities and start talking about what really might be reasonable and what we can really hope to achieve there. That's a bit of a dodge because I'm not sure, certainly don't have the answer to one size fits all question tonight, but I invite you guys to sort of lend us your thoughts on that because we're going to be thinking about that a lot in the next couple months.
With that, let me open up the questions. All right, so here's some questions that folks have been jotting down. I think some of these, wow. Willis has a date. I'm assuming that's what I was about. What else could that be?
Who is it?
let's take a different question before we explore that one. A waterfront as complicated as the one we have in New York, New Jersey. And this is the question, how do we determine which industries make sense on the waterfront? Let me just maybe add a little bit to that. I mean, it's a complicated waterfront. We have a lot of terrific maritime industry that need that and depend on that waterfront access. And are limited in their ability to kind of have the public nearby for all kinds of safety reasons, legitimate or you know, whether that's legitimate or just the perception of it. How do we balance that on the waterfront? And so both the, you know, how do we determine which industries make sense in the waterfront, and how do we find that balance with industrial uses and waterfront activities? I can put that to the panel.
I could start, but I'm sure Willis and Erika might have some thoughts. But I think we can look at other areas where that has been done. I mean, there are areas in the Netherlands where you have sort of a balance of maritime and access. And I think, you know, we can look at those areas and see how it's done, been done successfully. And we do have some examples here. I mean, we're starting to a Newtown Creek, for example, and Willis showed us some good examples of how you can kind of increase that and raise that baseline.
Yeah, I mean, just to follow up on that, I mean, one of the issues is how, I mean, with Newtown Creek in particular, but other waterways as well, is when you have properties that are at the waterfront that aren't utilizing the waterfront for needs that are essential to being on the water, like parking lots, essentially, you know, especially. So I think there's, you know, having an idea of what a priority is, that somebody from the public should be able to at least see the water as a baseline, but also thinking of ways that you can have people be able to get there and see it and maybe get down to the water, but doesn't inhibit, you know, what's happening there already is an interesting thing. I saw, I mean, one of the interesting things too about, you know, there's a lot of comments about bulkheads earlier, and it's such a huge issue, especially with environmental restoration, is that there's so little. You know, if your bulkhead collapses or needs repair, you just put in the steel slab because it's the cheapest, easiest thing to do, and it provides absolutely no ecological function whatsoever. And there's so many little things that we could do. So I think, you know, that's one thing environmentally, but also this thing about, you know, decaying piers. I mean, this is a big issue as well. As we've turned away from our waterways of maritime use so much, or it's changed so much in the past 60 years, and we have all these rotting piers that, you know, are just, you know, hazards for small boats and inaccessible for the public. I don't know, it's just something that the city should be focusing more attention on.
Yeah, actually, one thing that I think is important to acknowledge, and I think it would be great to kind of delve into a little bit more, is safety and the perception of safety and what's really safe and what's not. And I think that's often sort of discussed as an issue, but I think we need to delve into that a little bit more. So what does that actually mean, and what is unsafe? And so that ranges from the issues of port activities, and then you've got super fun, you know, I think there's a lot of perceptions from the public that things are unsafe in some areas where they might be, and then vice versa. And so I think that bears further conversation.
So why don't we just sort of drill down on just one of those? I mean, I see a couple of questions, maybe I'll try to combine, which is, you know, obviously kind of, you know, swimming is maybe the ultimate public access about being able to sort of jump in the water. And there's relatively few places in New York City, I think there's just 6 or 7 legal bathing beaches, as Kate indicated in one of the slides. So, you know, I think a couple of questions here, you know, how can you learn whether it's legal to swim or not? You know, why can't we swim at 72nd Street? And, you know, getting into that kind of safety conversation and the mechanisms for maybe thinking about encouraging swimming in certain areas relative to the sort of water quality conditions that are there. I don't know if folks want to comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about like the plus pool, and I think it's a great, you know, there's so much energy and excitement behind it. When I first heard about the project years ago, my first thought was that they were presenting a narrative that New York waters are not swimmable. And that's true if it's after, for waterways like the Hudson, the East River, if it hasn't rained recently. But I go swimming in the East River every summer, and if it hasn't rained recently, I know the bacteria levels aren't dangerous. So I feel like there's a education that can go along with that of telling the story about how much our waterways have improved in terms of pollution, but that it is, I think the pool is interesting because it is addressing this issue of access, that if you want to go swimming the East River, there is no, you know, there's very few places where you can get in. There's absolutely no legal place where you can go swimming. But yeah, that's my thought. And I think education, I mean, that's, yeah, every summer there's, you know, there's always like people drowning every summer because they get in and they don't realize, you know, 72nd Street is like, there's some pretty strong currents there. If you're going in at the wrong time, if you're not a good swimmer, you're not familiar with it, then it can be very dangerous. So I think the education, and a lot of times the city, maybe the approach is to just fence something off, and if people still want to go swimming on a hot day, they can just climb a fence and they're not going to know anything about the water, as opposed to acknowledging the risks. And I think they're getting a little bit better about that, but like acknowledging that there's some risk there, and the education aspect I think is really important, that there's commercial traffic, there's tides, there's pollution, and that's a way also to get people engaged in the issues of cleaning up the waterways.
Yeah, I think Willis pointed out, so there's basically the issue of education about where and when you can and can't sort of get in the water and touch the water. But then I think to Rob's question also, safety is obviously a really complicated thing. I mean, you're not really touching the sort of toxic sediment of Newtown Creek when you're there, but then there's the bacteria. So it becomes very complicated very quickly. But I think what we can also sort of look at is we are seeing more wildlife coming back to Newtown Creek. That's of concern to some people. Others are excited about seeing that as sort of an indicator of a revival. I think we can use all those things to sort of inspire us to kind of act a little faster and figure out what we can do in these areas and look at them with a sort of more careful eye.
Just a comment. Oh,
yeah.
You have a question?
No, no, no.
Oh, just a comment. I feel like what's inspired me in learning about a lot of the waterfront groups is the ability to look back over time and history and to think about the way that we use the waterways in and around New York and New Jersey hundreds of years ago and what we're doing today. And also to keep in mind, you know, with a longer arc towards the future of not giving up on these things just because right now, you know, they just seem overwhelming, they seem complicated. You know, there's this patchwork assemblage of groups and sites and places, and they all have a different story to tell. The reason why I'm so hyped up on stewardship groups and these kind of things is because they're the keepers of that story, which we're always going to need to hear, and they're always pertinent to a particular site. At the same time, there are groups like the Waterfront Alliance and other larger scale groups that can keep the eye on the prize of what is good for all, like swimming. We should be able to swim in the water eventually. When it's going to be, now that's another question, but it doesn't mean, you know, you have to kind of, you know, keep that long arc of history pointed towards the future as well, and do things today. I think of all the stewards I've ever interviewed, and they've always spoken about being inspired by another person, often a person who left the community 10, 20 years ago, or someone who had passed away. You know, people pass things on, and you know, you passed, you know, your organization, right? You said it was there before you, and so on and so forth. And I think we have to keep these things in mind, keep telling these local stories, and keep our eye on the big picture together.
There's a nice parallel, I think, between all of the stewardship groups sort of springing up in those areas where there is less green, and then also seeing egrets. I was telling a friend that I was just in San Francisco this past weekend, and I saw mussel beds all over, I think it's Merritt Lake in Oakland, and I was shocked at that. And so these things are going to spring up there regardless, and they are, and they're coming back. And so I think we just need to figure out how to manage that and how to deal with that and how to encourage that. So
let me try to combine a couple of other these questions and right on that point in terms of kind of, well, what, you know, what are other communities around the world doing to promote access and stewardship? Are there good examples both here in the metropolitan area that we should be sort of modeling? And I think kind of more broadly, you know, what is quality access? What does that mean? You know, how would you guys define that? Again, I mean, we sort of talked about it a little bit before, that it's not necessarily, you know, kind of a metric, you know, hard and fast 10 minutes from the water, but, you know, is there something that, you know, that defines sort of good quality stewardship and good quality public access to the water that implies good stewardship?
Because it's different, right, for everyone in some ways. But, you know, there's got to be a minimum quality of access. It can't be throughout the entire waterfront, right? But again, it's in certain areas, in certain places. Sometimes it's a view. Sometimes it's actually getting in the water. Sometimes it's engaging with it in a different way, like fishing, but that people feel ownership of it. They feel like it belongs to them, and then they're not being excluded. I mean, that's the big thing. That would be the counter to the quality, is that people do not feel that they are excluded from the water. And that's how I would measure it. And you can be excluded in a number of different ways, you all know, by other groups, by a big barge in your way,
Are there any groups, Willis, that you think of and you were like, well, gee, you know, when Newtown Creek Alliance grows up, we really want to be like...
Yeah, I think the organizations in the Bronx River Alliance and Rockin' the Boat, you know, they've done such a good job over the years of, one, that it's so community-driven, but they've also done, you know, they've connected all the people living nearby with this otherwise, you know, overlooked resource. So I think the way that they've done that, and then they also, you know, they've worked with the city to create more parks around the Bronx River as well. I think that's like really one of the best examples in the city of creating access and stewardship and community engagement in the waterways. But I did want to give this idea that came up in a lot of the comments about, you know, development, and when you were talking about not having people feel like they're excluded, but also feel like there's a flip side that sometimes people feel like they have more ownership over the waterways. So with development on the waterfront, you know, maybe others share this concern that you're having, you know, large residences go in near the waterfront and they're there for their view, you know, and that's like their experience with the water is looking at it from, you know, kind of like here, but, you know, it's obviously this wasn't built to sell it, you know, as condominiums, but, you know, what that relationship means of someone having, and what's a more powerful relationship? Is someone's view more important than someone else being able to cast a rod or, you know, catch fish or launch a boat or whatever? And I think that's one of the issues in the city is this, how the, you know, capitalizing on these waterfronts and how that might exclude other people, and it's some one person's priority or, you know, relationship with the water, it ends up being more important because it has money attached to it.
So, again, trying to combine some of these questions, and I think there was something on the other, you know, earlier in the scroll as well, but, you know, there's a bunch of questions here about, like, how do we do this? How do we engage, you know, the communities, the underserved communities, to collaborate on improved access? How do you figure out which stakeholders you need to come around the table? I think there were some questions earlier on about how do we get politicians involved to come up with the resources. You know, for these underserved areas in particular, you know, what are kind of some of the sort of first things or starting points you can think of in terms of community organizing and getting people engaged in this?
Make friends with everyone. I mean, the story of, you know, and Willis was talking about Bronx River Alliance, right? You know, in many ways it was an unlikely group of comrades who got together to do these things and engage the federal government, engage the local government, engage different entities. I think NOAA provided the initial funds. I know the Forest Service gave a small grant once. What's the Forest Service doing on the Bronx River? I remember one of our program officers asking. You know, you have to explain these things away sometimes, but the reality is seeing this as a whole social ecological system, and it's important to all of us. So, you know, as much as we know about, you know, stewardship networks and stewardship turf and these groups and the waterfront and who's there, we don't know as much of who's not there, who we haven't engaged, and what are the other potential partners that are out there that care very much about all those issues that came up in the world, you know, that care about issues of freedom, care about issues of boating or whatever it is, but, you know, finding how people... you know, come at this and can be allies with us, I think is really, because you can't have the perfect set of partners in every location. You have to do with what you can, where you've got it, and tell your story.
And actually, I'd love to hear from some of the people that I know are actually here too, and hopefully will be in the next few weeks as we continue these conversations. I mean, we're the Harbor Estuary Program. We work sort of at a planning level view for this project that we did, but I think that there's a lot of tools that could be very cleverly used based on those data that we collected and passed out to communities and talked about. We don't necessarily have the capacity to do that. A lot of that outreach, that's hard work. But our friends at the Catalyst Program and Parks and others, you know, I think those are real good groups that maybe could work with us and kind of take some of that information and use it in a way that benefits them.
Yeah, and I think just to build on that, I mean, certainly I know, and I know Roland will attest to this as a longtime community organizer as well, is, you know, understanding what you don't have and how you're not being treated fairly is always a great message that politicians want to hear, right? If they feel like their constituents are getting screwed in one way or the other, you know, that's not what they want to hear, and that's something easy to get their interest in. And so we certainly, I think part of the, you know, obviously we collected this data, it's publicly available, but folks are interested in using that to kind of show how well they're doing, you know, how they can thank somebody, or how they can sort of say, hey, you know, where's ours? I think that's certainly something that we're happy to work with you on, and we encourage that.
To show that it's possible. So many people just beg off things because they feel it's intractable or too much trouble. But if you know, show yourself as like, we're willing to do this. And it is possible. And I think your question about where, I mean, we have lessons all around us, right? Throughout the Northeast and on the West Coast, I mean, it's happening all over. So it's a little bit more subtle about what needs to be done here, right? Mm-hmm. Because there's plenty of good models. How do you get it done, and how do you stay in the game? And, you know, a lot of people wear out in any business, but especially in this kind of business, and especially community groups and individuals, and how do you keep the momentum up and their people's spirits up by these, you know, small acts of positive action, and that, you know, eventually we will be able to swim, but for some it may not be in their lifetime, but how do you still engage them in that process?
Right, and how do you, and I think this is, will be our, I think our last question, if we need to end at 8, but, or at least maybe the start of our last question, somebody typed in, how do you measure success? What are the indicators of success for the initiatives? And I think we can take that at a number of different levels. I mean, obviously there's, well, can you swim or can't you swim? You know, can you launch a boat or can't you launch a boat? Can you get to the water's edge or not? I guess I'm interested in hearing a little bit about kind of the sort of stewardship success. You know, I know there's a certain mentality that I think we all have that as civic groups get organized, they're gonna, you know, you're gonna get a couple of neighbors together, they're going to sort of put on an event, they're going to get people to the water, they're going to do something fun like, you know, have a free kayaking or whatever, and then they're going to start getting some money and maybe even some paid staff. You know, is that the right measure of success, you know? Is there sort of a right size for these stewardship efforts at a kind of organizational level, or, you know, is it so, you know, really there isn't, you know, it's too diverse to kind of come up with something?
Oh, I think it's a really great question, and I would say that there's plenty of groups that don't want a $100,000 budget for paid staff. There's many groups out there that want to keep doing what they're doing because it's part of what they're interested in. They do just things kind of gently and move the ball forward, so to speak, and it's part of their lifestyle and their interests and their hobbies. Then there's groups that sure could absolutely want to staff up and create, you know, a larger entity. So I think it varies and it depends. So the success, really, the measure of success, if there's still someone out there with a voice and we're hearing it and they want to, you know, go forward. These groups have been around for hundreds of years. It's, you know, not as well documented as those who, you know, built and worked around Central Park, but, you know, one can imagine it wasn't the only open space happening in the city 2 or 3 years ago, you know, but on a smaller scale.
Yeah, little, sure.
And so, you know, it's part of being human. We need these things. And I think politicians know that. I know, you know, just everyone knows that. It's just how do you get the momentum and people gathered around your particular story in your place? And then how does your, what you do, contribute to the whole?
So maybe less.
If that works together, then I think that is really a successful model. where groups in this side of town are doing good things, or groups on that side of town are doing good things, and they're contributing to a larger movement. And then, you know, you've got not just a technical aspect or a green design or the, you know, engineered solution, but you actually have a social movement. And that would be my measure of success, how this turns into a social movement, which I think it already has.
My background is in science, so this is going to be very metric-based, but I feel like this is maybe the less exciting. But, I mean, we definitely hope to kind of look at this from the metrics of, are we increasing overtime, linear access, are we changing use from an esplanade to actually touching the water? I think there are some clear and obvious metrics for success. I'd love to see us delve into some others, kind of like what Waterfront Alliance and others have done in the past, looking at awareness or education through our sort of harbor literacy points. How much do people actually know about the water? What's their perception of the water? That's not necessarily what we work on, but I think there's sort of the metric base, and then there's the sort of broader question of awareness and is it fishable and swimmable, which I'm not sure which part of the trajectory that is, you know, whether it's actually more sort of longer term, those are all sort of tough to interpret, I think, but those are the kind of two things that I see.
Willis, any parting, like how do you...
I think that sometimes it's hard to measure because, you know, I think we talked a lot about like organizations and the stewardship, which is really important, but there's also like all the value that's really hard to measure of someone who, I don't know, goes to a waterfront park once a week, and for them it's a very special place, and how do you measure how special that place is to them? How do you even know that person is there? I mean, for me, it's just like seeing people at places, but I think there's also something about having access points or waterfront spaces that are also, there's this, you know, the freedom and this, like, this whole idea that it's a, whatever, there's some sort of freedom that goes along with being at the waterfront, and I think that's, you know, for me, that's always been, I always want to try and find access points where there's not a really siloed, prescribed way to interact with the water, but it's more like, you know, you have a path here, or you can, you know, or someone's going there to do a yoga routine or something like that. But I think that having people feel like they have their own way to interact with that space is also kind of important as well, but very hard to quantify. So.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. I know, you know, for those of us of a certain age who have seen sort of the evolution from kind of a lot of informal access to kind of terrific big regional parks, that'll be unnamed, where access is more prescribed because all of a sudden they're big regional institutions. You know, it's great to see that diversity still happening on the waterfront and that kind of personal experience still happening. And we don't want to lose that. As great as those parks are, in some ways that's kind of the industrial strength access, you know, which serves as a great, you know, serves a lot of people, serves a great audience. But it's not for everybody, maybe not for every water body.
Yeah, that's a definite
message. I just want to also, I don't know if people have seen Nathan Kinsinger, who's a photographer, and he's been doing these articles on Curbed on the website for the past year and a half about sort of the lesser-known waterways around New York City. And they're really terrific because it's a lot of these places like Coney Island Creek and elsewhere where they're not, you know, there's no, it's not where there's thousands of people going on a weekend. And they're kind of the next frontier in terms of creating better access. But the way he captures them through photographs and interviews with people, you know, it's this, again, this very like informal relationship that people have. So they're really great articles. I recommend people check them out in terms of new spaces.
Great. Well, I think we're at the witching hour. So I really want to thank our panelists. Who always does a terrific job of getting us together around important issues on the waterfront. I know there were a bunch of questions we didn't get to, and probably we're all going to stick around for a few minutes, so if you didn't get your question answered, in particular the phone number question, Willis is here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thanks.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, wait. One more.
Hold.
Thanks, everybody, for coming. I want to thank all the participants and thank Bob again. And we hope you'll join us next week for a more in-depth discussion of some different models and innovative models of waterfront stewardship. So we're hoping to continue this discussion next week and throughout the next couple of weeks. So come join us. Thanks. I didn't have this one.